So your mom put you in dancing class when you were young?
Yeah, because my mom used to be a dancer herself.
Oh, okay. Oh, really?
Yeah.
What type of music did she dance
to? So she used to do Caribbean folk dance back in the Caribbean, Martinique. Hmm. And it's how she got brought to Europe to be a professional dancer.
Oh.
Yeah.
That's so interesting.
In Luxembourg before going to Belgium, by the way.
Wait, I'll say that again?
In Luxembourg.
So she Luxembourg?
Yeah.
Oh, that little bitty nation.
The little bit of nation.
Yeah, that nation is big as Burbank.
Yes.
And when you look at it on the map, I'm like, what is this? Is that a city? It's like, no, it's an actual nation, Luxembourg. I only met one person from Luxembourg.
And they speak, I think they speak three languages over there.
That small city speaks three languages?
It's a country.
Okay. All right, you can call it a country all you want. I guarantee there's more people in Burbank than there is in Luxembourg.
Yeah, probably.
Well, for sure.
Probably.
Wait, so your mother put you in dance. How did your father feel about you dancing?
I mean, my dad wanted me to be a lawyer.
As he should, because he's a Congolese man. You're going to be a lawyer. Mbote, welcome to another episode of the Bantu Boyz Podcast. I'm your host, Baleko Azizawisa here. And today, ladies and gentlemen, we have a very, very special guest. We're here with Angel Kaba.
Kaba, yes.
I had to look down because I was like, I was going to say Daba.
No, I don't eat Daba anymore.
Why not?
Because I'm vegetarian now.
Vegetarian?
Yes.
African vegetarian?
Is
that kindoki? You know that, right?
No. No, absolutely not. Come on. It's just like the food is just bad in this country.
Wait, in this country?
Yeah.
Well, yeah, in America, the country, the food's terrible here.
It's terrible. So then I just decided to stop, you know, eating meat first and then just making research about what I put in my body. Because as I'm a dancer, as you know, I have to pay attention to what I put in my body.
Good for you. Because you know, in America, kids will be 12 and be diabetic because we just eat a bunch of trash.
Very true.
Yeah.
Oh. I used to really, like, as you said, learn a lot about the food system here. I would even use system as a word.
Yeah.
And also like the label, because it's completely different. Compared to Europe, the dosage and everything is just different. And then I ended up having like high blood pressure.
Oh, no.
And then I changed my diet and then now it's gone.
Oh, well, good for you. I'm happy you're here. Not really, but you know what I'm saying, right?
Yeah, you know, yeah, just because it's this fries that I didn't give you.
Let me tell you, ladies and gentlemen, let me tell you something. We're in the car. She has fries and doesn't offer me one.
Yeah, but I don't know him like that.
What? You're in the car. I'm driving. The car is like my house. You're in my house. You got to offer me the food.
It really looks like your house.
Okay, that's enough. That's enough. This weekend, I'm going to clean the car. That's enough.
I didn't say anything.
No, you said a lot. Okay. You said a lot. Right. You called me a messy person.
Oh, no, I didn't.
Yeah, you sure did. But anyhow.
You revealed yourself.
Yeah, you're right. But we're here with Angel Kaba. You are a dancer and choreographer.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So you are Congolese and you are.
So my mom is from Martinique, the French Caribbean Martinique.
Holla.
And my dad is from Congo Kinshasa.
Oh, Sangaboni. Okay, good. So wait, well, your mom's from Martinique. Do they be doing that thing where like they've been doing like, you know, the seasons where the women be like in bathing suits and the breasts be all out? Do they do that? You know, like other islanders where they be having like the kid, they're dancing in the streets.
They do have the dancing. You talk about the carnival.
Yeah, do they have that?
Yeah.
Yo,
yeah.
I need to be there.
It's not as big as Trinidad and Tobago and all those stuff. Or even like the carnival, the Jamaican one in Notting Hill. Like in
Yeah.
It's not as big, but yes. Yes.
We need to go.
Yeah, let's go.
I'm trying to see as many, many top and bottom chicks as many as I can.
Oh, that's the reason why you
want to. Not about the culture.
You're going to go by yourself.
Not for the culture.
Anyway.
No, right? Okay. So, since you are a choreographer, you know, we ask everybody this question or whatnot. Do you have a Congolese approved degree? Like, did you go to school first? And then you became a dancer? How did, like.
That's a good question. The Congolese degree is very interesting. You know, like I say to my student all the time, like, born and raised in Belgium, like.
Uh-huh.
It's nothing new for me to be African or neither Caribbean. So I am African every day. Mm. So it's easy because when I teach who I am. And I teach a part of, you know, It's in my DNA. So this is for the degree, the Congolese degree part.
Yeah, yeah.
But then, yes, I did learn dance at an early age. I was 6 years old when my mom put me to the ballet, and I did ballet for like 15 years.
Uh-huh.
Then I switched to the hip-hop. I was very into... I'm still teaching hip-hop, though, but then I think I fell in love with the hip-hop culture back then in Europe.
Uh-huh.
It really helped me to express myself in a different way. And then, you know, the whole, so I don't teach traditional, I teach only contemporary dance, or they call it the Afro'Dance, whatever they want to call it. But again, for us, it's nothing new. So it was a way for us to celebrate, each other outside of the continent. Mm. So, you know, the African diaspora, the Congolese diaspora, when there is music, you know, we don't play, we just dance.
Right.
And it's nothing new. Now it's new here in America. It's more relevant for certain people. So then,
It's funny because it's really new on the West Coast, like Afrobeat, if you're not African.
And that's the reason why I push a lot to say, like, I don't teach Afrobeat. I teach Afro'Dance because I'm not Nigerian.
Mm-hmm.
And my roots is not Afrobeats. My roots is Ndombolo or Coupe Décalé, Afro House too, you know, from Angola, as we're not far from each other.
Right.
But then I teach some Afrobeat steps with Afrobeat music. Nothing against that. But I'm not going to teach Afrobeat just because it's trendy.
Right.
You know, I used to dance Ndombolo like, 20 years ago, stuff like that.
Oh, so you're like a purist.
I'm not gonna say that, but I think I stay true to who I am. I'm not trying to fit into any kind of box. That's not who I am.
Okay. So your mom put you in dancing class when you were young.
Yeah, because my mom used to be a dancer herself.
Oh, okay. Oh, really?
Yeah.
What type of music did she dance?
So she used to do Caribbean folk dance back in the Caribbean, Martinique, and it's how she got brought to Europe to be a professional dancer.
Oh.
Yeah.
That's so interesting.
In Luxembourg, before going to Belgium, by the way.
Wait, I'm saying it again?
In Luxembourg.
So Luxembourg?
Yeah.
Oh, that little bitty nation.
The little bit of nation.
Yeah, that nation is big as Burbank.
Yes.
And yeah, when you look at it in the map, I'm like, what is this? Is that a city? It's like, no, it's an actual nation, Luxembourg. I only met one person from Luxembourg.
And they speak, I think they speak three languages over there.
That small city speaks three languages?
It's a country.
Okay. All right, you can call it a country all you want. I guarantee there's more people in Burbank than there is in Luxembourg.
Yeah, probably.
For sure.
Probably.
Wait, so your mother put you in dance. How did your father feel about you dancing?
I mean, my dad wanted me to be a lawyer.
As he should, because he's a Congolese man. You're going to be a lawyer. You see this one. You see this one behind you. You know what he is. He's a lawyer.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So my mom wanted... My mom always... Like, you know, my mom was like... She was like, if you're good at school, if you do what you need to do at school, you're fine.
Oh, okay.
No trouble. You don't bring any trouble at home. She let me do hip hop. She let me wear my baggy jeans. And then I was like wearing my clothes
baggy
like
Aaliyah jeans.
And crisscross. I was like doing all of that. She was like, yeah, you're fine. Crisscross.
Did you wear your clothes backwards?
Yes.
Oh, okay. That, you're so corny.
And I thought it was cool, and my mom was okay with that. So I know you're not nice because of those French fries. But
hot. I'm steaming.
So that was that. But my dad, you know, my parents never lived together. They were like separated when they had me.
I'm sorry.
So no, it's fine. And then, so my dad never really took that seriously until I got to perform at the Zénith de Paris for Salif Keita. Wow. Then it was the first time it was like, oh my God, so yeah, that's big.
You have a talent.
Yeah, kinda. My dad is a very good dancer. Uh-huh. You know, my dad is Muluba from the Kasai Oriental, and he's a very good dancer.
Oh, that's dope.
Very good dancer.
Just let you know, I'm Bakongo, real one. Get at me.
Okay, Baluba, strong. Très, très fort.
Très,
très fort.
Très, très fort. Okay, we out here. What dances do you like specifically do?
So I teach hip hop and I teach Afro dance.
Uh-huh.
I call, you know, my technique in my class Afro dance and not, like I said, Afro beats.
Mm.
Some people start, you know, getting to know it more and it's become something more familiar, and then people understand more the technique and what is it about, and also the difference between Afro dance and Afro beats.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So the culture is very important to you to like inspire your choreographer.
A lot. Right?
Well, yeah. How do you feel like, do you think through like dance? I know we went over questions like earlier before, but I'm just thinking right now outside the box. Do you think dance is a way to like kind of like I don't say bridge the gap between culture and people, or to make people more aware of the culture, because like people don't realize like dance is a huge part of like culture.
Yes, it you is. Know what I mean? It is. That's a good question. I feel like I have this natural, I would say, gift of bringing people together. And I think it's also, it comes like easier, I would say, just because of the dancing aspect, right? Yeah, yeah. If I open the conversation and let's talk about slavery or let's talk about colonization, you know, certain people in the room might feel uncomfortable.
Yeah.
But when you put the music and you start moving, make people moving, at some point, there is no judgment.
Yeah.
So beside that, you can open conversation then, you know, about more specific topic without make people feel uncomfortable.
Yeah.
Because I have a lot of diversity in my class. Right. I want to, it's very important, you know, to me, the culture. So I really speak my truth to it. But again, I don't want to make people feel uncomfortable, but I just wanted them to understand what is it about and the reason why I'm doing that, because I could do, you know, I have a BA in marketing management. I can do so many things, but
there it is. I knew it. We knew you had that African degree. Exactly. It was in there. You thought you were gonna let it slide by. I knew your father was gonna let you just go through. I'm just gonna be a dancer. No, you're going to get the degree.
Exactly, the degree.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay. That marketing definitely has to help you out with like your dancing, right?
A lot. You know, social media and everything now, it's so different. Like talking about 25 years ago, it was different. So now, yes, the marketing does really help me to be like very aggressive on social media.
Ooh, and aggressive. A lot of ours, huh?
You know, very aggressive, very, as you say, relevant. And just stay, you know, in the, what'd you say, in the trend.
What's popping. Mm-hmm. Let me ask you this, Yaya. What is the Kai African style?
Oh, the Kafrican.
Kai African. So,
in 2011, wrote this question. I don't know, someone who's a lawyer, I think.
Yeah, he's a jack.
Didn't say that. In 2011, I got, you know, I came here with my ex-boyfriend.
You weren't married and you moved with a man to the States? See, that's the problem with you kids, man. You guys have no structure, no order, and then you get HPV and coronavirus.
Oh, my God. It's just disgusting. Well, what I was about to say.
Look at you, swag.
So, yeah, 2011, I came here with my ex-boyfriend and we stayed like for 3 months and it was like our big dreams. Blah, blah. And he used to be an actor and a singer too.
Uh-huh.
But for him, it was more complicated because of the language barrier. But me, as I was a dancer, I had an opportunity to really like get into the dance community, pretty fast. And I got spotted by my mentor, Miss Robinson. She's the person who brought the hip hop outside of the street in the dance studio.
Oh, nice.
So basically, if the hip hop is the hip hop today, is because of her, because she saw something in the hip hop. She was like, "Yo, you guys need to learn how to structure yourself, so then hip hop becomes something big." And she's the first person who introduced hip hop at the Alvin Ailey Broadway Dance Center and all those big studio now.
Let me tell you something. That Alvin Ailey, I know he said this on the car, but he said it on the podcast. If you can ever go to the Alvin Ailey like theater company and see a show, that's incredible. I saw it once and I was like, this is incredible.
Yes. It's one of the, you know, I was a fan of Alvin Ailey when I was back then in Europe. My mom introduced me to him and to his work. So I would never like think in my life that like I would be able to work over there.
Yeah.
So yeah, it's something big when you're a dancer, choreographer, when you dance world, it's very big. So I'm very proud of that. And I'm really, you know, every day I feel grateful for that. So she saw something in me. She was like, the way you move is not like us. I'm like, what do you mean? She's like, in your hip hop, there is something different. And I was like, no. She was like, yes, you need to brand it. It was way before the Afrobeat became, you know, super big. So she was like, you need to find a name and really like, you know, brand yourself because there is something more African about you, even in your hip hop.
Wow.
So that's the meaning of Kafrican, which is African and Kaba. So Kafrican.
It's funny because you keep bringing up hip hop, right? And I don't know, I'm here in the States, so I'm in hip hop.
Mm-hmm.
When has hip hop like been, has hip hop always been prominent where you were, where you grew up?
Yeah, so my mom, like I told you, was a dancer. So she was about the disco and the funky and all of that. So she's the one who introduced me to the
disco,
to the dancing and, you know, to all of that. She was always open-minded about music and stuff like that. But then at the age of, I was a teenager when I really, you know, came across, I would say hip hop, but rap. I was rapping, I was writing.
Yeah. You got bars?
You know, that was a long time ago.
Yeah, you said it with no confidence. Just that, feel like, yeah.
That was a long time ago.
Let me say something. You can't have bars with that accent, okay? That's not going to work.
Yeah, it's going
to be. No, go ahead.
So I remember the Zulu Nation in Belgium were like organizing hip hop, you know, party. And I was going there by myself and I was like amazed about it, you know, about the positive energy. The talent, of course, and it was beautiful for me to see that. Different. Yeah. It was not really the new, because it was very underground. You know, I was like, I don't know, 15, and I was by myself in the Zulu Nation, like, party, like, you know. So it was very, it was different, and I really loved it. And so we do have a different type of struggle in Europe, right? Yeah, so that's the reason why hip hop is so big over there too, like big, like huge, because of that. So when I did realize other kids like that look like me were like experiencing the same struggle, I felt, I don't know, like moved and free to express myself in a different way, because like, I mean, ballet. And I was like, I don't know, from 6 to 16, I was doing ballet. I was the only black girl. It was very, very hard, you know, for me to just express myself through that. But I learned a lot, you know. So hip-hop came across, and then it was just like, I don't know. It was deep. I was a fan of Tupac.
My favorite rapper. Shake my hand. God bless you. Okay. That's the only thing.
God. And all these, you know, hip-hop artists, French hip-hop artists that maybe you guys don't know. But yeah, hip-hop is very big in Europe too.
It's funny because, like, you know, the root of hip-hop always comes from disenfranchised people trying to find a voice. Because I don't know if you know, out here in the 60s and 70s or whatever, you know, remember jazz was big. But then when they took away jazz out of the schools, humans have to express themselves creatively, whether it's dance, music, painting, or any type of art or whatever. So it just gave this rest haven for hip hop, and that's where hip hop comes from. So it's funny to hear you guys in Europe that are having like social issues where it's like the way we can express ourselves is still through hip hop. Even though you guys have never been to Compton, you guys have never been to Harlem, never been to, it's amazing, right? There's always something in the air around the time and airway.
That's huge. And for me, when I teach, I always like to bring that, you know, because it is important for people to remember the reason why, you know, hip-hop
exists.
Yeah. And then the whole thing about Africa Bambaataa and all of the struggle were happening in the Bronx and stuff like that. I think
it's
important for the people to really know about that, because the hip-hop now is so, as you say, it's mainstream. So sometimes people forget about the roots, and the roots is really the reason why I fell in love with this culture.
So you must not like new hip hop, huh?
Some.
You like Tatiana?
Yeah, I think it's cool. I think, you know, I work with kids all the time. TikTok, and you know, I'm very like, you know, I know what's going on and I know what's happening out there. So I'm not someone who's like, you know, but I like to remind them the roots. I like to remind them where the hip hop is coming from, so then they don't forget their own, you know. Because I'm amazed sometimes. I'm like, oh, when you see like all these dances, right, that come from the ghetto, right? All these dance, you know, those kids, I mean, in our community, because outside of our community, people can really see the difference between you and I, African American, Caribbean, and African, right? We know, but outside of our community, people don't know. So I just want to,
you're black.
Exactly. So I wanted them to remember how beautiful they are, how strong and powerful they are, so then they can,
you can use in other fields of life.
Say that. But they can also like celebrate themselves more, because people can see the talent. And I'm over there too. I'm in the industry. I'm in the entertainment business. So I see how people are taking stuff from the community, taking stuff and make money.
Oh, yeah.
So I wanted them to really understand that. So that's the reason why I'm about the Tatiana, the, you know, the whole thing, you know, the beefs and signs, because I want to know, you know, I want to stay relevant. Do I like everything? Not really. You know, I watch a little bit of, you know, hip hop, and I forgot the love and hip hop and stuff.
Oh, I love hip hop. I love the women. I love hip hop.
Whatever. So, yeah, I'm watching, you know, I watch videos. I need to know what's going on.
Okay, so you're from Belgium, you grew up in Belgium, Congolese, mm-hmm. Martinette. Mm-hmm. You live in New York, you mm-hmm. visit LA. Do you notice any difference between dancers and choreographers, like here in the US, like versus Europe?
Yeah, yes. People are way, it's not, you know what? That's also a good question. It's not about talent though. Because mm-hmm. again, you know, the whole thing about the history, if you go deep, deep into the dancing, l'Opéra de Paris and all this stuff, we do have talent in Europe. It's not even that. It's just, I would say, the motivation. There is a different level of motivation, dedication, and commitment. Also, we don't have such a huge industry like you guys have here.
Yeah.
You know, the entertainment business. We talk about millions and billions. Like,
yeah.
I was watching the numbers on Broadway. I think, like, The Lion King, the musical on Broadway, even after almost 20 years, they still make millions per week.
Yeah.
That's money.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So then it, you know, sometimes I'm like, yo, I still have to push, because outside of the community aspect, there is like money, and I want to be, you know, I want to have a seat at the table.
Yeah.
I want to have 1 or 2 million too, and then, you know, share it with my community. I would like to see more people that look like me make more money with our own, you know,
art and
whatever. Because at the end of the day, the only musical that talk about Africa on Broadway is The Lion King, and they talk about animals.
No humans.
You know what I mean? So I'm like,
It's funny you bring that up, because like, you know what? We'll come back and we'll continue this conversation about The Lion King with Angel Kaba.
With a man get on the nine brain, more bright sunny day. Adi ya the king and every day me a rain. Lyrical jokes we go straight in a vein. IQ height of his stain at the plane. Come bring me never dead the wind. Table a deck so me still drink rum in up. Me no blame.
And we're back. So we were talking about The Lion King, I lost my train of thought because you're a bully.
What do you mean?
Like, you know, bully, like people that bully people.
Yeah,
this is what you are. What? Yeah, so I forgot my train of thought because you were like when we in between the commercial break, you like were bullying me, and I was just like, I lost.
Oh my god! That's not true. Can you move your feet, please? Thank you.
Oh, she's so rude. But anyway, so we were talking about what am I talking about?
Yeah, we were talking about the business, like what was the difference between like
LA and New York.
You were talking about Europe. Yeah, in Europe you don't have that huge entertainment business. Mm. I mean, now I would say it did change though because of the internet, because the kids have more access to, you know, music, and they can really share their music worldwide. It was not the case at least like another 15, 20 years ago. So now, yes, people have more access to music, especially if we talk about the African music. And I think that's a good thing.
Yeah.
I think it's beautiful for us, you know, whatever you want to do, right? We were talking about that on our way. Mm-hmm. Like for me, whatever opportunity that I have to talk about my culture and who I am, I'll do it. So it might be small, or some people might be like, oh, you don't really do anything for the country. I mean, by just being myself, by just telling my story and inspiring other kids that look like me, for me, it's already a good thing, and it's already huge. And I mean, I could do so many other things to make money, but I really decide to take that path of just create a better future and opportunity for my community.
That's good, because like, you know how people always say, well, what are you doing for the country? What are you doing for the country?
Exactly.
Some people that are saying that, like, you have a class and you have a, I guess we haven't got to that question yet, but you know, if you're teaching kids, that's the best way to give back, because that helps the future.
You know what? I think so. Having conversation with them about, okay, let's do the nene together, whatever you want to call it, you know, in my French accent, so they laugh at me and stuff. And I'm like, do you know the potential of that? Let's talk about money, right? How much that represent? Like a kid from the hood or from whatever the kid's coming from is creating the nene or the yo-yo, the way, whatever you want to call it, right?
And then the pee-pee.
Then whatever, right? And then you have the rest of the world like with that doing it.
Yeah.
If we can, as you say, translate that in numbers, it's power.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So you guys are powerful. So opening the conversation as an African woman, Caribbean, you know, with them, talking about them, and based on my observation and my own experience, for me, it's huge.
This is great. Let me ask you this. What about, because you talked about the difference between US and Europe, and you said earlier about motivation, right? Because there's so much money emphasized in America about entertainment.
Yeah.
That's what people are like, no, if I can do whatever to get into entertainment, because, you know, there's residual, damn it, there's other opportunities and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. What about the difference between LA and New York? Do you see a difference in dancing?
Yeah. I like New York. Like, it's more, I'm sorry. It's just like more, it's not rough, but there is something deep and something real and something like in your face about New York that I like. I mean.
Death Row.
Yeah, I know. But it's just a different vibe. I really don't know how to describe because I'm not from here.
No.
But this is really like, clearly, you know, it's just like, you know, New York got me. I don't know. It's the train. It's, I don't know. There is so many things about New York.
Oh, how about the big rats?
Also, you know, I like the rats. No, I'm joking. There is something about New York that I don't really know how to describe, that energy. Now, in terms of dancing, I would say, you know, you have Broadway, you have all the classical training
that you
can find here too, but you have this classical training that you find in New York. Mm. Like, I mean, the Alvin Ailey, right? It's in New York and all of that. So,
but the irony about Alvin Ailey, he went to high school in LA.
Yeah, I know.
But
the company is
based out there.
A reason.
You know what? You know
I think the theater world and stuff, and Broadway stuff like that, is bigger over there. I think here, like, it's more, as a dancer, right, is more commercial.
Yeah.
If you want to do, I mean, I don't know, tour and then do backup dancing for big artists.
Yeah.
So you better to be in LA. You know, me as a teacher, as someone who want to do Broadway, want to work with the community and stuff, I don't really need to be here. Like, maybe when I was dancing, yes, probably. You know, in New York, you don't really have to take 15,000 classes. You have to know the right person. No. You know, you just take your train. You don't have to have that much money. You take your train. There is an event. You just go. You show up. You know what I mean?
No, I agree, because my sister went to a school in New York. Mm-hmm. So the subculture in New York and theater is respected. Like, mm-hmm. theater isn't respected. Like, it's normal, it seems like, in New York to mm-hmm. be like, hey, it's Saturday, let's go see a play. Yeah. Like, out here, we have to see the plays, The Lion King. It has to be something gigantic for us to see a play. So that's the subculture there. So I can understand where it's like...
You and
can
also, be when you see it with the kids, the training that they have, it goes from tap, ballet, to hip-hop, to freestyle, to flexing, to... They go deep into, you know?
You know, we were talking about knowing your history. They'll mm-hmm. do that in New York because, like, tap was so important.
Yes.
Especially with, like, jazz and all that stuff. No. So I understand. I get it. We're very... It's more... The business is more commercial out here.
Yes.
Yeah. I think if there's an industry where it's, like, you have to, like, really grind out here, it'll probably be comedy and probably hip-hop.
Mm-hmm.
But, like, those other, like, you... Like, dancing, talking about dancing, like, out here you can just definitely tell, no, I'm going to be in a music video.
Mm-hmm.
You heard what I mean? I want to go on tour with with Beyonce and stuff like that.
Yeah, so you better. I mean, Beyonce lives in New York, but then, like, I feel like some big decisions.
Of course she does.
I'm just saying.
Huh? Oh, she does? Oh, okay. I'm surrounded by the beehive, huh?
Yeah, she's in Brooklyn.
Of course she is. Oh, by the way, you're talking about you moved here with your ex-boyfriend that was a actor mm-hmm. and a singer?
He was, He was doing rap, and then it was...
I just wanted to add that he was also a waiter.
It was a what? A writer?
A waiter.
No, he was not.
Oh, a lot of actors here, you know, they're all waiters.
No, he was not.
That was a joke.
You didn't...
I wanted to put that on.
You didn't do your research.
I didn't do my research. Well, we did our research on these questions. I'll tell you that.
You did the research.
What about the difference in dance between the West and Africa?
What do you mean, the West and Africa? West African dance?
No. Like the West, like Europe and America versus Africa.
All you call us the West. Okay.
God.
The West.
Gosh, we can stop this podcast.
What do you mean in terms of training?
Yeah, I mean, like, what do you see any differences? Like I don't know, maybe training, even the business.
Yeah, like I was saying earlier, it's like, there is more opportunity here. The business is bigger. You have more money. Mm. I mentioned like Broadway and stuff like that. Even like for a music video, you have more money. It's just money and the opportunities. You have more money and opportunities here compared to Europe.
Mm. What was that? Maybe this will lead to the next question or whatever. Mm-hmm. Have you ever danced in any of your parents' home countries? So have you danced in Congo? Have you danced in Martinique?
Yeah, I did.
Martinique.
So I did a musical in Martinique for the France, and it was the first time and the last time my grandma, saw me performing. She saw me on stage.
Cool.
Yeah, she passed after, and then she was so proud, so proud of seeing me performing. It was nice. It was a musical, Caribbean musical. It was in Creole, in French and Creole.
Mm.
And then, yeah.
Oh, what about Congo?
In Congo, I did a performance with this company, and it was for the, as you say in English, le cinquantenaire d'indépendance, so the 50th anniversary of independence of Congo. Right. I flew with actually the King of Belgium.
Really?
And the ambassador of Congo in Belgium, and all this, you know, very diplomatic people. And then we went to celebrate the 50th anniversary of the independence in Congo. And I did perform at Wallonie Bruxelles.
The King of Belgium, was it like Leopold's grandson? What is this?
It's not grandson, but yeah.
Oh, let me see him.
It's the same. You know, it's the same blood, it's the same bloodline.
Oh, that's so funny. Okay. Oh, wait, hold on. Who are dancers or choreographers? Is that how you pronounce it?
Choreographer, we what?
Yeah, there it is. You can just fill it in for me. Is there any that you like respect or look up to?
I like Tanisha Scott. She's she's in New York, but she's from Canada mm-hmm. and she's Jamaican mm-hmm. and she really made it on the commercial side. So she's, I don't know, she worked with Drake. I mean, she really made it when she toured with Sean Paul,
uh-huh.
the first album that he got big.
Yo, she was touring. That first album was incredible.
Right. So she is how she got her name out there, and she's amazing. She's very
humble. Wagwan.
She's very humble. Uh-huh. She's very professional, and she does so much good work on the commercial work. So I really love what she's... And then I had the opportunity to work with her when I did the VMA with Rihanna.
What?
Yeah, I did in 2016. I did the VMA with Rihanna.
So if I stole your phone right now I can find Rihanna's phone number?
Nope. We were not that close.
Why is she here, Patrick? Come on, man.
We were not that close. But she's cool, though. She's mad cool. I was not expecting her to be that cool.
When I get this money, when I get this, I'm going right to Rihanna. We're going to make this work.
Yeah, she's very beautiful. She's very humble. She's very professional, very detail-oriented. I was observing every single move she was making.
Can she cook?
Say it again. Oh, I don't know. I don't know. She didn't look obnoxious.
She looks like she can cook, though.
She looks like she can be a very good wife.
See, you're half Islander. You know your people. You can tell she can cook.
Yeah, she looks like someone who can cook. Yes.
May God bless you. Just wait. I'm coming.
Yes. But, you know, her wine, though. The wine was not that. No, I'm joking.
Hey, look. Don't worry. I'll take care of that.
Oh, no.
He said, oh, no. I could've. Okay.
Wait, what was the question again?
No, I said, what dancers do you respect? But we went on a tangent.
So, Tanisha Scott, and I also like Camille A. Brown. So, she's more on the a musical theater, Broadway type of thing. She's also amazing, talented. She's African-American, and she made a piece out of, I think it's Black Girl Spectrum. Mm-hmm. So she created a piece out of how Black girl and how a community moves, you know, so the whole dance and stuff, the thing that I don't know, but that I did learn about it.
Yeah.
So she did that to really express the Blackness on stage. So that was pretty powerful. She did a few TED Talk and stuff like that.
Oh, strong.
She's good. And she also likes to die a lot about the South African technique. So she incorporate some kambut and then also the stepping and stuff like that in her vocabulary. So she's very strong. She's a very strong dancer, amazing choreographer. So there's two Black women that I really look up too.
This is amazing because this is a whole different science to dancing. I'm just thinking like you just hear the beat and go, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Is there any one of them or any other dancers you wish you could work with or wish you could have worked with in the past?
Not really.
Oh, okay.
No, you know, I think I'm good with who I am, what I've done, and what I'm supposed to do.
Mm.
You know, as artists, you're an artist too. We always questioning
the
process.
Yeah.
Am I good enough? Am I on the right path? Maybe I should, you know, do that. Maybe I should change. Sometimes you're just good at what you're doing. That's all. What are we looking for? You know, what success mean?
Yeah.
Success, is it popularity? Is it money? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So me personally, if success is, you know, building my family because I'm a mom now, being here, teaching kids, make sure like I stay true to who I am every day. So if that is success, so I am successful. So
good for you.
You know, if I work with, I did work with Camille Brown, for instance. I did work with Tanisha Scott. I wish I can work on the same level, but not work for them, but work as them. Yeah, that might be my next move, but. Mm. At the end of the day, if it doesn't happen, I feel like I'm good where I am at right now.
Oh, okay. What about you? You wouldn't want to dance with Michael Jackson?
Yeah, I don't want to dance anymore. So I feel like being on stage for me is just,
I've done that. Even when you were younger? Like, I just picture
I love Janet Jackson, for instance. That would be like my dream. If you call me tomorrow and be like, yo, Janet Jackson want to have you on stage with her. I might say yes, oh my God. And then I don't know if I still want to be on stage behind someone.
Oh, okay. I feel what you're saying.
You know?
Are you ready to be the lead?
Yeah.
Oh, there it is. Okay. So this weekend, you'll be judging the African dance competition in LA.
Yes.
That's in March, right? Could you talk about the competition and your role in it?
That is tomorrow, actually.
Tomorrow?
Yeah.
See, this leap year shit in February. It's ridiculous. Leap year. Leap this.
Leap this.
Yeah.
So I think it's the third edition or something like that.
Mm.
I don't really know them. It's really our first collaboration.
Mm-hmm.
I'm always, you know, I'm of course Congolese and then Caribbean, Martinique, but I'm more Pan-Africanist.
Oh, good for you.
I love Africa. From the inside and from the outside.
Mm.
I like my people. This organization, they do a lot of work for the community in Africa. So they bring people from Africa here and they create this huge network. So the guy was like, I'm interested about the dancing too, because I feel like dance is a huge part of the community.
Huge part of anybody's culture.
Exactly, right? And he's from Nigeria. And I'm like, I like to connect with everybody.
Right.
You know, so I want to learn more about how Nigerians are working together. You know, they're good at business. They're very good at business.
They're good at emails too.
Yeah, that's another side of me. But yeah, you know, and they do a lot of business, especially, you know, the Afrobeat is taking over.
Yeah.
I'm like, yo, that's not gonna happen without us. I don't care.
Yeah.
Like me as Congolese, I'm gonna have, you know, my foot everywhere, because I want to know. I want to be a part of it. I want to push the conversation. I want to, you know, support each other.
Yeah, but you can't, you know, you can't do music in Africa without Congo. Everybody knows. Like, it's funny because, like, I'll be at a comedy club, and let's say, like, an older, like, Nigerian or an older Liberian man will walk by me, and he'll be like, oh, I like your set. You're from Congo. Then he'll be like, so do you know Papa Wemba?
Of course.
You know what I'm saying? Like, yeah. Those will be like, oh, yeah, of course.
You know, yeah, if you're African, you know. You know, yeah. When I said I'm Congolese, like, people already know. They're like, okay.
Yeah.
There's nothing, you know what I mean? Yeah. They know.
They know.
on est juste les plus forts, on est les meilleurs, on a une des plus belles musiques du monde. Et,
Wow. That masculine voice comes out. I'm so rude. I'm sorry. Yes, I'm so rude.
But it's okay. It's just because you're not funny.
Right. Okay. The negative. You're on my podcast. Yes, I heard, Yaya, that you want to open a dance school in Congo. How are things going with that goal?
It's not a dance school. It's more like a performing arts center.
What's the difference?
Dance school, it's a dance school. So you go in a school and you learn dance.
Makes sense.
Performing arts center, you learn every kind of performance aspect. It could be theater, it could be singing, dancing, acting. Of course, acting, music, everything.
You know what, Africans need to learn? Improv. Improv is so fun.
It is fun, yes, and it's also a performance. Yeah, yeah. I would love to have something like that in the curriculum. But you know what? Since I moved here, of course, Congo will be the easiest and, you know, my base and stuff. But then I don't know. Now I get to know more communities in different countries. I don't know. You know, like, it's, I would say Africa. Uh-huh. I want to develop a project in Africa, and I want to have one of the best performance art center in Africa. I want people from around the world come in Africa and train themselves and learn from us.
They already do it. Best.
Yeah, but it's not formal. They just come, take what they have to take, and they leave, and they're going to make money.
Yeah.
It's just long now. You're going to come here and train and really learn and respect our art. Because we respect our art first.
Yeah.
If you continue let people come and steal and take, and then we agreed on that because it's cool or because it's fun, so then, yeah. But me, I'm going to be like, mm-mm.
Yeah, if you do that school, you can do it in I mean, you can have different points of distribution. If you do it in Congo, you do it in Kenya, you do it in Brazzaville, you do it in Nairobi, you can do it.
I was thinking about Kenya, yes.
Yeah, because if you were to do that, like, because.
And I didn't know, like, people from Tanzania and Uganda, how they love Congolese culture and music and everything.
Yo,
I didn't know.
Yeah, we met a girl from Kenya. Mm-hmm. We were at a concert and she found out we're Congolese. She was speaking fluent Lingala to us. And I said, wait, how do you know Lingala? She was like, well, I'm from the west side, so we speak Lingala. I was like, wait, what?
They know everything about the music, the dance. Even they don't really understand. It's like me when I was listening to hip, I was like, oh, what you want to watch that one?
Oh, you should have seen her. So look, Azul was performing, right?
Oui.
Yeah, and this girl was on stage. She was like, no, I love Congolese music. She was Kenyan. I was like, this is so odd.
It is so. But then you have to be African or to know about African culture to know that.
And Zoto Naye is ali makasi pe.
Qu'est-ce que t'as dit?
J'ai pas très bien compris. Oh, her body was incredible.
Oh, okay.
Anyhow.
Nothing to do with the conversation.
No. But I had to let the fans know that I care. And I'm a creep. No.
All right, bye.
Okay, wait. How do I pronounce this person's name? What was your reaction to... We'll be back after this. back here with Angel Kaba, right? And I'm going to ask you a really tough, serious question.
Wow.
Yeah. What was your reaction?
Wait, I don't know if I'm ready.
Oh, look at the swag. You're calling people ugly off camera? You think I don't know?
Oh, my God. Never. I would never say something like that.
Yeah, she called me ugly during the break. She was like, you know, you're not that handsome. You ugly.
No, I said, you're not funny. That's different. But you're ugly, too, if I have to.
Jesus Christ. That hurts. Yeah. No. Let's see how you get home. All right, look. What's your reaction?
You're very cute.
Ah, merci, merci. Mm-hmm. Can you send that send that clip to Rihanna?
Okay, I will. Yeah. I sure will.
Yeah. What's your reaction to Dulo Dilo being a part of Shakira's Super Bowl performance? How do you feel?
Wait, I need to breathe.
Corona. Corona.
No, please. I still need to make money. I want to be in quarantine. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
I read a lot of reactions, positives and negative.
Ooh.
And I'm kind of
in between.
Proud of, yeah, in between, but it's still a huge exposure for Congolese music.
Right.
But the sad things is like people don't know it was Congolese music.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Because of the confusion between Chapeta and the whole thing. Mm. So, but again, what I liked about Shakira stayed really true to her roots because she's from Colombia and she's from, that I didn't know, I made my research about it, but she's from the Caribbean part. So one of my students, she's from Colombia, and she told me how when the African came as slaves, right? Mm-hmm. There is this huge African roots in Colombia.
Right.
And a lot of African that arrived as slaves were from Congo.
Oh, yeah.
So
yeah,
when you listen to the music, you can, yes, obviously recognize
the melody, the beat,
exactly.
Tempo.
So then I understood the confusion and the connection. So it's not wrong. There was nothing wrong about using some Congolese music and doing some chapeta.
No.
There was nothing wrong about using some hip-hop music and do some contemporary fusion or ballad. Or even take a classical Mozart piece and do some freestyle hip-hop.
Yes,
right?
Yes. Uh-huh.
So for me, artistically, there was nothing bad about it. But then my question is like, if we have that many exposure, if we have that many opportunities, who's at the source? Who's the choreographer? Who's the artistic director? Who took that decision of putting Congolese music and doing some chapeta on top of it? So, you know, I use that as a fact in my class to keep teaching, to keep pushing the culture, to keep pushing the conversation. So then we're going to have more jobs.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Yeah. So is it bad? Not really.
Yeah.
Is it a big celebration? Not really.
I would hope, like, hopefully, like, in the future to see that if you are, because, you know, especially here in the States, you know, there's a lot of big, like, Congolese artists, even growing up, that never acknowledge their Congolese self.
And them as artists?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Right. And if they would have, let's say, for example, let's say I blow up, right? I will. And you guys will make me blow up. I blow up, right? I do a music video and I'm like, I want to do something cultural.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, hey, let's put some, we're going to do our music, we're going to have our choreo, dancing, right? People would be like, oh, well, I didn't even know that they had that there. You know what I mean?
See.
So it's like, it's our responsibility.
Exactly.
You can't allow somebody else on the outside to be, it's their responsibility to show our dancing.
Exactly. Right? Exactly. So that's the reason why, you know, I have nothing negative to say about it. I'm just learning. Moving on, you know, I'm trying to stay super clear. I make my research myself to make sure, like, I come up with, you know, real accurate information so then people can still learn. I did a post on my Instagram because I made my own research and people were like, oh my God, thank you for sharing that. We didn't know. I didn't even know there were like a lot of Congolese slaves that arrived in Colombia. I didn't know about that.
Oh, you should research. You know, in Brazil, 85% of the slaves were from Congo.
That I knew. Yeah. But then from Colombia, I didn't know.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And then the whole chapeta and whole thing. I really made my research. I watched video. I'm a dancer. So I could, you know, read, you know, the technique and the dance style and understanding the beat and the musicality behind it. I was like, okay, makes sense.
What technique is this?
It looks like some shimmy shake fake jewelry, Africa.
It's not fake. I got it on Amazon.
Heard. So Amazon is legit.
Yeah, sure, sure.
Legit Amazon.
Amazon Prime.
Okay. Is that like a stain or something? Like, is it like a real?
Yeah, this is $7.99 with free shipping and handling. Okay. I don't care. I don't care about y'all judging me.
No, we're not judging you.
Bling, bling.
So, yeah, right. So what do you think?
What do I think? Like I said.
Is it a good thing or a bad thing? If you have to pick a side. I would say good if I have to pick.
No, it's just like, it's just history repeating itself. Like, it's just like, you steal from us and not even to acknowledge, but it's like, it's up to us. Like, so if, for example, like, look at, this is why Michael Jackson's the greatest, right? Michael Jackson would bring Ladysmith, remember Ladysmith, the people from South Africa, the singers? Mbonza, right?
Oh.
Right? And he'll bring them in and he'll have them in the video to be like, hey, look, these are, I'm influenced, they influence me. Like, I like them. And he'll put them in the video. So if she was to do that and they did all this research, there's nothing wrong. Like, picture if she brought in Dulu Dulu,
mm-hmm.
right? And they're like, and people will be like, who's this African guy in the back? I'm like, oh, this is the guy that created the dance. And she could have gave him opportunity. You know what I'm saying? Because, like, think about it. Like, you know, I'm a scientist, my background, right? If I reference your work, I have to make a reference point and be like, this is where I got sure, this,
sure,
right?
Sure.
And that's just, and if you don't in, like, science and in writing or any type of writing, that's a plagiarism. That's fraud.
Yeah.
So you know, I am watching, like, we know a big-time artist that mm-hmm. copied some big-time Congolese artist a couple years ago and did the exact same music video. You won't even acknowledge them?
Yeah.
And you did the exact same music video.
Yeah.
But if we did that to them, oh, their lawyers would be on our heads. Oh, you're stealing this, that. You know what I'm saying? So there's not even no, like, creative integrity.
Yeah.
That's what bothered me. Because we're artists. At least have some creative integrity.
I feel like there is something very important that you bring. Is just like when it comes to art and when it comes to culture, like people don't really respect or acknowledge sometimes. You really have to fight super hard for people to respect you or to value you or to acknowledge who you are. And then it's not like you said, science and doctors and lawyers and all of that. But it's, again, it's our responsibility to really, like, push for that.
Yeah, have creative integrity.
But then that, working together as a community, right?
Yeah.
You have your background in science.
Yeah.
You know, we know lawyers, like, we need to just sit down and have conversation about that. What can we do?
Yeah.
You know, this case happened. What can we do? Oh, okay, I'm a lawyer. I'm going to push the case. Let's see. You know what I mean? So then people's like, oh, okay, we're not playing with them anymore.
Yeah.
Stuff like that.
Because to copy somebody's music video, frame for frame, like, you're not even trying. You're not even trying to lie. You're like, I'm just stealing it.
Yeah.
And then not even acknowledge them.
But then if we go back to that specific, you know, situation, uh-huh. it was just Shakira uh-huh. doing some chapeta from her culture, her country, using some Congolese music that sounds like chapeta music. So for me, it was not stealing. It was just like a mix and a fusion about things that people didn't know.
Yeah.
If people knew the Congolese music, and then it's sukus, it's not even dombolo, it's not even like people call Afro-Congo and all those things, right? It's really sukus. And people just didn't know. It sounds like, hey, exotic.
Right.
You know, it sounds exotic. So people's like, oh my God. So again, it's up to us to really, like, make sure, like, people respect us and people learn, you know, what's going on outside of America also. And the inspiration is always good to acknowledge, like you said. I went to see a show 2 days ago, West Side Story, super classical music theater.
Yeah.
And it was a revival with, like, Belgian director and a Belgian choreographer. It was really interesting to see how the American audience react. They hated it. They're like, why they didn't use the choreography, like the initial choreography? Why, you know, because you touch about something classical.
Yeah.
Something that touched by their own story, right? Yeah. So it was like,
Let me tell you something. I'm the host. You don't ask me questions. I ask you questions.
Oh my God.
So I'm just kidding.
I didn't ask you questions because I want to know what you think.
We're getting close. We're getting close to wrapping up, right? Okay. So with you seeing the Congolese music getting highlighted at the Super Bowl, what do you think is the future of Congolese dance and music in the United States?
I think it's not a future. I mean, it's present.
Ooh.
Like, we're just there. It's like I said, it's nothing new. We've been killing it for, like, decades, and we're going to continue doing that. Okay. You know what I mean? It's just like, using maybe more, what you say, be thoughtful
yeah.
about how we use social media and how we are presenting ourselves. That's the reason why I like to say, you know, Angel Kaba, I'm from Congo and Martinique, born and raised in Belgium. I'm French. It's very important for people to understand the history behind Congo. Congo was colonized by Belgium. So by me growing up in Belgium, that means a lot about the Congolese, you know, story, the colonization and everything. So the way we move, the way we dance, everything is in there. So I feel like us as Congolese, it's important for us to really keep acknowledging and keep being, like I said, relevant about what we want to, what kind of information we put out there. And also when things are happening like that, the way we're reacting. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like the whole thing with Fally Ipupa. Fally Ipupa is doing a concert right now.
Yeah,
in Paris. And it's been like 10 years. Like he couldn't perform in Paris because of this, a part of the community called like Les...
Really?
Les
10 years?
10 years. Yeah, 10 years. Les Combattants. Yeah. So they're like, no, we're not going to let you perform here in Paris. You know what I mean? So it's important between us, how we are like interacting with each other. What is the purpose? And that's how people will respect you in the future, but in the present. I mean, I have no problem for people to respect me. You're going to respect me.
Good for you, because you respect yourself.
Exactly.
I don't respect you, but you respect yourself.
I'm going to make you respect me.
Whoa, I got it on tape. I can send it to the police. You don't even have a visa out here. They'll deport your ass.
I do.
Deport your ass so quick. Oh, they'll deport the hell. Oh, you're black? They'll deport your ass so quick. Trump does not.
If you have to leave. You know, he always does this with his hand. Trump, I'm Trump.
Yeah, this guy is different. That's your president because you're American. I'm not.
Oh, okay.
Mm-hmm.
It's funny. I was going to say I support my president, but no, this guy's aloof. He's a child. Okay, well, we're coming to the end of the podcast. Mm-hmm. We asked everybody this.
Mm-hmm.
What is your spirit animal? Like, what's an animal that has characteristics you wish you had or you think you share? Like me, I think it's a Black Panther. Quiet, okay. Straight to the point, sleek. It's probably things I want to be because I'm not really like that in person. Nothing sleek, nothing smooth about me. But I wish I was like a panther. I do like to eat food in a tree because, you know, a leopard, they can eat their
food. Yeah, you look like someone who eat food in the tree.
We're going to delete this podcast.
You really look
Let's
like
find
that.
Out what this podcast
is. Don't you think so? It looked like someone who eat, I don't know, type of fruit, like, I don't know, vegetables or stuff like that.
I don't eat vegetables.
From the you said Fumwa?
Yeah.
So.
Okay, you remembered, okay. All right.
Animal.
What's your spirit animal? You're a sloth?
That's a good question.
A Gerber?
That's a good question.
A rat?
No. A rat is ugly, like you.
That's number two.
I'm sorry, it was too easy. Yo, I don't know. I think
an eagle, a mongoose, a snake, a mamba?
I think an elephant.
Oh, why an elephant?
Because it's smart. Because it's kind. Because when it's really angry and upset, you don't play with them.
They have good memory.
And also, and they live super old.
Really?
How do they live? I like the wisdom. Getting old, it reminds me about wisdom.
Oh.
And then also it's a strong representation of Africa.
Good for you. Do you know what color elephants are?
I think they purple, no?
Purple. Okay, wow, not your hair. I said elephants. All right.
I think they purple.
No, they're gray. No. But people think they're black, but they roll themselves in mud to keep themselves cool. So people think they're black. They're actually gray. You don't even know elephant.
But I knew they were.
You said
I
purple.
Knew, no, I knew they were gray, but I was like, why is
she asking? Thinks they're Dumbo. Oh, they're purple.
I'm like, why is asking me that? Yeah. You know what I mean? I'm not a stand-up artist comedy like you, my friend.
Stand-up artist comedian?
I don't even know. How
yeah,
is
such
the
an elitist.
What is the order of? Is it stand-up comedy, artist, whatever it
no,
is?
No, just stand-up comedian. You're terrible. Okay, well, tell the people where they can follow you and where.
So you can follow me on Angel Kaba, K-A-B-A, and voilà. Thank you for having me. It was very interesting to talk with this guy. He's very smart and it's a cool guy. I think he's cool.
Wow.
And I hope I'll be back and then we're going to have more conversations like that.
Oh, no, we're going to dance.
No, I don't want to dance with you. I don't know you like that.
No. We don't have to dance together, but you can teach me how to do something.
No, I don't want to teach you anything. You don't deserve that.
You know, see, you give them an inch, then they think they're a ruler. You see what I'm saying? It's terrible. So there's just that on Instagram.
So wait. Which dance you wanted me to teach you?
Whatever. I don't know.
Okay, we're gonna do some dumbbell. Okay, we're gonna do that.
Yeah, whatever.
I don't know. Is that
yeah, whatever. When you come back from what you call it, paying child support in New York, you can come. We can come. Do this dance.
Yo, some word. So Angel Kaba, K-A-B-A, on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, Snapchat, TikTok, everywhere.
All right. And make sure you guys follow the Bantu Boyz on Instagram. Like us on Facebook. Follow, subscribe on YouTube. Comments. Leave. Tell us what you like about the episode. Tell us what you don't like about her hair. You know what I'm saying? And we'll respond. And thank you guys so much. We'll see you guys next week.
Thank you.
This is ridiculous. Like you said, I want the five.
I want all five. I want, what is it?
It's word, touch.
It's word of affirmation. Yeah, like I want exactly. I want my man to be like, oh honey, you look beautiful. Even if I don't look beautiful, you need to tell me I look beautiful. Like even if I look like my hair look like.
Well, if you don't look beautiful, why don't you don't deserve care. That compliment?
Even if it's something simple like, oh, I don't care. I just want my.
It dilutes the compliment.
Period. even when I'm looking my roughest, I need my man to be like,
yeah, you're looking beautiful.
Period. I don't want to hear nothing else. I want what I want. I want what I want.
In all seriousness, I don't think that's reasonable.
How is that not reasonable? Is it not reasonable to want whatever? If you want somebody to touch you, a partner that...
No. Physical, right? There's physical. Yes, there's words of confirmation.
Yes.
Right? There's
I have the book.
Yeah. Hold on. Oh, wow.
I just downloaded it.
Of course you do.
Yes, I like to read, y'all.
You know what I mean? You can't ask somebody to be perfect. That's not reality.
I'm not asking for perfect.
But those are like...
I want it. Ha ha ha.